buzzard took a monkey for a ride in the air. The monkey thought that everything was on the square. The buzzard tried to throw the monkey off of his back, but the monkey grabbed his neck and said, "Now listen, Jack. Straighten up and fly right."
Recently, there has been an issue with the selection of Heather Wilson as the next university president. There are many people who find this selection very problematic. You are two of those people, and I'd like you to just talk about your concerns and why you think this just isn't a good idea for us, and what you're doing to protest the selection of Heather Wilson.
Well, my name is Michael Gutierrez. I am a student at UTEP, first and foremost. I am a gay male, and I am a Latino. So,
me too.
So, it's quite concerning to me having somebody such as Heather Wilson be the sole finalist, because it's her track record and everything has been completely shocking to us. When we were researching her entire track record, it was just completely like, wow, why would you consider this person? Because it's somebody that's not for the people, in my opinion. It's somebody who's not...
What would you tell someone, say, well, you know, apart from that, mm-hmm. and even they'd say, well, you know, that's not good. But just because she does not find gay rights to be a particular concern to her, does that mean that that applies to everybody else?
No, it completely does, because her educational background... her education voting background in Congress shows that she's voted against Hispanics, she's voted against African Americans, and UTEP is a school that is predominantly Hispanic. So it makes no sense to have somebody like that. Yes, there is her LGBT background that's completely abysmal, but her background against like Hispanic people is just as terrible.
If you had to characterize Heather Wilson, not by meeting her, but just on her paper trail, it would lead you to believe that she is not an open person. Is that what you would say? I'm not sure.
I would say not. Because I have actually everything right here.
Okay.
In 2006, she voted no on an $84 million grant for African-American and Hispanic students. In 2006, she voted yes, I'm building a fence along the Mexican border. In 2006, she also voted for not tipping off undocumented immigrants about the Minuteman Project. And the Minuteman Project was a group of vigilantists who would go after undocumented immigrants.
Right. And not tipping them off.
Yes, and not tipping them off.
There was a law proposed that the immigrants be warned that there was vigilantes on the border.
Yes.
And she voted against that law.
Yes, she voted against it.
Did she give a reason why? Is there a public reason why she voted against that?
I don't believe there's a public reason why. I don't know if you want to go ahead and introduce yourself while I look for that information.
Yes.
My name is Melissa Trejo. I'm a graduate student at UTEP.
You're a graduate student. What's your major? What are you getting your graduate degree in?
I'm hoping in borderland history.
Borderland history.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes. And my bachelor's degree is in Chicano studies.
Nice.
Yes.
You're a radical.
I guess you could say that. Well, people might think or may say that I am. Yes. So, I mean, the reason why I'm against it, it's just mainly because we are a binational community and a binational culture. And during her press conference, she says that we had potential to become a binational community and bicultural, you know, We have potential for that at UTEP. The thing is that we already are that. So how can you say that we have potential when in reality we are that? We need someone that's going to come in that already understands that. That phrase alone made me believe and made me come to the conclusion that she has no business being here at UTEP. She doesn't understand the population. She doesn't understand the culture. She doesn't understand any of that. And I guess the biggest thing that really got to me was when I found out about the LGBTQ community. And here, there's a big community like that here. And they're very you know, like it's one of the El Paso is one of the friendliest places for gays. And I just didn't like that. I didn't like that she voted against so many things about, you know, equality. And not only that, the border wall, like that's a big one for me too, especially with my family being from Mexico. So there's just so much. And it just really fired me up when I saw all of this information.
Well, I'm going to chime in here. Mm-hmm. One of my concerns was that, you know, I've been around a long time. And when I first came here, I wouldn't have considered El Paso to be LGBTQ friendly at all. But I wouldn't say that it was like anti either. It was something that you didn't speak about it. You just didn't talk about it. It was well, live and let live. And El Paso is very much a live and let live town. One of those reasons, I think, is that people are really busy trying to just survive. You know, they're not, you know, they spend a lot of time knocking other people down. And they're already down and out. But when you have a kind of an acceptance that's kind of like under the table, only because you're a human being, which is not exactly pro or, you know, like, or understanding the issue. And then you have, and finally this town, I think, has really been probably helped by the marriage equality movement, where people are, out, you know, that we're a public presence, gay people are. It's noticeable, for instance, in the, let's see, 10 years ago, I went to the Gay Pride Parade, and it was the saddest thing in the universe. I just thought, like, there are more people in the parade than are watching, you know, like, this is like, oh, I love my hometown, but Jesus, you know, like, this is sad. But you go now, and there's a noticeable difference. It's a real parade. Lots of people go. It's really like a public thing. It's become like, it seems like a community thing. And when we, and I think this town struggled to have a public discussion about gay rights. It helped along, by the way, with that kissing thing. And do you remember that controversy? Two boys kissing at Chicos Tacos.
Yes.
That actually helped because people started talking about it in a public way. And one of the reasons it was very interesting, the response to that, because, you know, they did a man on the street on the news. Mm-hmm. And those kinds of things, you know, there's issues and they just ask anybody. And it was really interesting because it could go, you could find all these people that are angry or everything. And mostly people said, oh, I didn't know about that. And they said, who cares? You know, that was, and another one was like, well, yeah, I heard about that. Well, let them kiss. Who cares? You know, nobody thought it was a big deal. Nobody was saying like, oh, I'm pro-gay rights. Nobody was saying that. But they were saying like, you know, why? I don't think that's a big deal. If they didn't like them kissing, and they just say, oh, we would appreciate it that you didn't do that right now. We don't allow public displays of affection. Well, which isn't true, because they always allow public displays of affection among straight people. Who's going to be offended by that? But in any case, that showed you that this town was like, none of those people might have known anything about being gay and didn't care to know. Frankly, you know, that's part of it, right? I don't want to know. But there wasn't like this, like a movement to oppress or to suppress gay voices. But when we've reached a kind of sophistication in this town where there is a general acceptance of gay people as, you know, full enfranchised citizens, it is disconcerting to have a university president who is on record of not exactly encouraging it's almost like her record shows, and you know, and I would say she would say like, I respect everybody, I respect everybody's right, and I'll be respectful of every student that comes to me, regardless of their race, gender, sexual orientation. Well, that's easy enough to do. When a student comes to you or a student has problems, that you respond to their needs is common human decency. But there is this thing called institutional racism and institutional discrimination. And the institutional racism and discrimination can exist, interestingly enough, despite the fact that none of the people are racist, because they have a system placed in that is so powerful that you just have a way of thinking and you're not aware of it. For instance, we talk about male privilege. And we talk about white male privilege. And if you know, I know a lot of white guys who are my friends. They go like, what are they talking about? I'm a good guy. That's not what we're talking about. We're not saying you're not a good guy. Right. You know, it's just that we have to recognize that in our culture. We privilege men. We do privilege men. We do. That's why men get on the dollar more than, get paid more than women. That's why there's still a discussion today in many factions of the United States where they say, well, you know, there are still people saying that today on the religious right, excuse me, that men should, that women should listen to what their husbands have to say. I mean, they're not saying that women should listen, a man should listen to what their wives have to say. Mm-hmm. We know what's going on there. We know that women are not treated as in the same way that men are treated by the culture, and very often it's mirrored in the laws that we have. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't mean that most men don't think that women should have equal rights.
No, yeah, and that's completely correct, because growing up in my household, my grandparents were the type of grandparents that were like, no, mijo, sit down, let us do it, let the women do everything, let your mom do everything, let me do everything, let your aunt do this for you. And my mom was like, no. My mom made me grow up in a household where it was like, no, you go out, you do it. You're hungry, I'm going to go teach you how to cook, you're going to cook for yourself. That's completely true in what you're saying. Because I grew up in that household where my grandparents were like, let the women do everything. The men can just sit back. And they took care of the men like it was nothing. Because my mom would always grow up saying, well, the guys had a lot more privileges than we did. They could go out all night. They could come home at 4 a.m. and my grandparents wouldn't say anything. But if we came back at no later than 10:30, we would get hounded on it.
Well, you know, I think a lot of these things are, that's why, you know, what happens in the public discourse is very important. We create a culture of equality, and then we follow suit. We also create a culture of gender roles. Hmm. My mom, you know, may she rest in peace. There are certain things her girls did and her boys didn't. You know, when we were all kind of taking care of her, my mother would not even let us be in the room if they were putting in her feeding tube. Not the boys. It's not nothing offensive. It's like, it's hard to watch, but because only her girls did, not her boys. And she always encouraged my sister, and she did when she was 9, that her girls take care of my boys. Well, you know, but that's kind of, it's sweet, but it's also, there's a gender disparity. I have a funny joke about that. My mom was dying, I was praying the rosary with her. And I had been really tired, and I was lying down on the bed next to her. And I wasn't really asleep, but I was nodding off. And then my sister came in, and she was talking to my mom, and she goes, ¿Qué no ves que tiene frío? ¡Tápalo! You know, it's just, and so like my sister and I have a joke, you know, like, ¡Tápalo! You know, but there is a kind of assigning certain roles to genders. And one of the roles that we have continually assigned to men is that they are in charge in a public forum. That's why it's so, I mean, why is it so incredible today that we have all of these women finally run for Congress? Like, that's news. Why is that news? Because there hasn't been that many women in Congress. Mm-hmm. So why is that? The kind of culture that we created, which takes us back to this issue. What kind of culture are we creating at the university? Diana, when she was president, well, she wasn't the least. whatever her faults were, she was not a racist in any way, shape, or form. She was she was incredibly comfortable in the culture of El Paso. She'd been here so long, and she was in the linguistics department, so she studied language and bilingualism and. All of that stuff, that linguist study. excuse me. And she was perfectly comfortable and didn't feel threatened. despite the, sorry. Some people in El Paso that are white do feel threatened because they are a minority in terms of the population. That didn't threaten her in the least. She wasn't the least bit homophobic at all. And so She created a culture. sorry. So she created a culture on campus that mirrored that. So there are, you know, we had, the city of El Paso had this big deal about domestic partners, which could apply to straight or gay people, and their insurance. And they thought about that. UTEP just had it. Why is that? Because of the leadership. And so if you don't trust that your leadership at heart is going to create a culture of equality, that becomes a problem. It doesn't mean that she doesn't, but there's nothing in her public record. And that's why she's, and that's how you hire people. Not what you're going to be like, mm-hmm. but what you were like. Is that when you get married? Oh, she'll change. Well, or he'll change.
Yeah.
Well, probably not. You're going to get a divorce. You know. And that's it. It's like, she may change, and she may, well, I'm not going to do that when I'm at university. And that may be true. But we're not hiring her on that basis. We are hiring her on her resume.
Well, from so far from her coming on campus and being here, she had that opportunity when we were protesting to come up to us, console the students, you know, tell us, you know, I was this way in the past. I'm not going to be this way. I want to preserve the diversity of UTEP. I want to preserve the institution. I want to preserve the culture of what you have here. And she chose not to. She went the back way. She went out
right
through the back way. And one main argument that somebody gave me was, well, would you go up to somebody if they were yelling at you? And it's like, I've done that my entire life. As a gay man, I've done that. I've gone up to people when I was an activist for certain things back then that weren't how they are now, like such as marriage equality. I would go up to people. I would go up to them. That's what you do. As a leader, you go up to people. You understand where they're coming from. You understand their point of view. You gather what the information that they're giving to you, and then you educate them. And she had the opportunity and she didn't. She chose not to.
And, you know, when I was told that, when I was told that she went through the back way, I have to agree with Mike. I mean, the way he said it was just on point. You know, it's ridiculous that you're coming into a university and you're saying that you want to lead this university, but you're not willing to face the controversy when it's there in your lab. There's going to be more issues that are probably going to arise, just like with any university. So is that what she's going to do whenever an issue arises? Is she just going to go through the back way and ignore the issues, or is she going to face them head on? You know, and being as a woman, I was a little excited, you know, when I found, I mean, actually not a little, very excited when I found out another woman was going to be our president. And then seeing her track record, it was disappointing. It was very disappointing. And I just want to, I guess, emphasize on the fact that her gender is not the issue here. The issue is how she's voted in the past and what people think she has potential for. It's like everybody has potential, but it doesn't mean that they're going to rise up to that expectation, because all of our expectations are different. We expect people to do X, Y, Z, and they don't do it. So I just really hope that she doesn't come to UTEP. However, you know, if it happens, then we'll just take the next step. I do know that we are doing a petition upcoming Thursday.
Yes, it's
right.
Yes,
Thursday at 2:00, we're gonna do a press conference at the plaza.
Yeah, we're gonna have it at the placita.
Yes, at the plaza. Yes, yes, downtown. And then from there, we're going to go to the Mills building, correct?
Yes, we're going to go to
the Mills building where
Paul Foster is. And we're going to give him the petition drop.
Yes, exactly.
I take it that in this whole process, you don't feel included.
I don't feel included as a community person that a person that's part of the community as well as a UTEP student. Because if I would like to know who was able to, but who was a part of the running. But I do also understand that there's a confidentiality to that. But I do want...
There are reasons for that.
Right, exactly. So I would have liked to know who else was in the running, but I know there's a lot of barriers and obstacles that makes it difficult to know. But I know that there was somebody else that was better suited and better qualified than Heather Wilson was or is.
And coming off of that point, I've discussed certain things with certain students, and apparently there was a town hall that they had asking students what they wanted, and they did it at 12 o'clock in at noontime when nobody was going to be there. And I think there were finals or there was some sort of testing going on where the students weren't going to be able to get on campus or be able to go to this thing and like voice their opinions.
Well, I mean, this is the problem. You know, theoretically speaking, the process might have been absolutely above board. But when you do things that make you suspicious, like saying she is the only candidate we have chosen. Exactly. When you only present one candidate, I know that there were many applicants.
Yes, there were.
There were a ton of applicants. So then I say, well, they only brought one because she's the one that stood above them all. And then you start wondering, well, you mean you're going to tell me, and then I'm talking as a Latino, you're going to tell me that among those applicants, there was not one qualified Latino that applied for this job? You're going to tell me that? Mm-hmm. I don't believe it. I don't. I actually don't. There's a lot of people out there that are absolutely stellar candidates. Now, you know, all things being equal, you have to make decisions, right?
Yes.
If everybody's the same, then I'm going to pick the one that's this because they have this. I get that. But see, that's what makes me mistrust the process, because I don't believe, or they're telling me, that there is not one qualified Latino to head this university where there's 82% Latinos, and you couldn't find one among the applicant pool. I don't believe it. Now, you know what? If they'd have said, look, but see, I don't know that. They allow me to say, to be suspicious. They allow me to throw that in because they've done that. That's the process they did. What is wrong, even with saying, we think this one's way up here, but we're going to pick three people. This is a national search. This is an important search. The people that we serve ought to be happy or satisfied that we had an open process. And so selecting one candidate gives people the feeling that that it's not an open process because it's a done deal. Mm-hmm. You know, we have always, when we had searches, national searches for provosts and deans, we bring three candidates to campus and everybody goes to listen. Oh, sometimes I hated that. You know, there we got another search. Yeah, you know, but we get an idea of like, and then we would register how we felt to the dean, would register to the provost, who would register to the university. And we could have never said in those searches that we weren't listened to, because if you didn't know what was going on, well, you didn't get involved. You didn't go.
Yeah,
well,
precisely.
Know, like, you know, you didn't get the memo, too bad. But that's not what happened here. You know, and that for me is the issue. It's not so, I'm bothered by the LGBTQ. I am bothered by the fact that they're telling me that there's no qualified Latino to head this university and that none of them applied. I don't believe it. Because what they're saying is, compared to her, we don't stand up. We're not good enough. You know, we are still not good. And I don't believe it. I do not believe it. I think that's a lie. And I will not buy that lie.
Not only above that, but there wasn't one who's went to UTEP who understands the community. A student that's graduated who's done already. There wasn't one person that you couldn't pick from there.
Yeah, exactly. And then I read, I was reading El Paso Inc. about, you know, what a stellar candidate she was. It was like, who wrote this? Your mother? Was this a journalist? Heather Wilson has been plagued by controversy her entire career. Yes. She was what year was she watchdog organization that voted her as one of the most corrupt legislators in Congress?
96?
I have it. No, it's recently.
Recently? Oh my goodness.
Or not recently, but it's been about a decade. Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington named Wilson its most corrupt in 2007.
Well, if I was hiring a candidate and I did that and I read that, wouldn't that raise a flag to me?
No, completely.
Well, why didn't it raise a flag to the people on the hiring committee? How many other applicants were called corrupt that by any organization in the way that they did business?
No, correctly. And in her ratings, it's just as terrible as just that. In her ratings in December in 2003, she was rated 33% by the NEA. 33%, indicating an anti-public education
record.
In voting record. In 2006, she was rated 0 by the Human Resource Center.
Oh my God.
For her anti-gay views and her voting record.
Well, see, when you add all of that up, you wonder why was she the best pick? Is there a kind of those kinds of negative things about any other candidate? I think probably not, but they weren't considered. Why was she then the person that stood up above the rest, so far above the rest, so excellent that they chose her? That does, when you are, it raises flags for people. It gives people cause for concern. So it's when someone said, "Oh, Ben," I had someone tell me, "You're just upset because of the gay issue," and I said, "Well, no, I'm not. No, I'm not.
No, it's about."
I said, "It concerns me. It concerns me that on the face of it, the public face of it, you have Republicans appointing a Republican. You know what?" I don't know Diana's political affiliation, and I don't want to know. It's none of my business.
Correctly.
But they pick someone directly from the Trump administration.
Yes.
I wouldn't want to have that on my resume.
No. Yes. And then.
And then they say, Republicans picking a public. She's quite partisan. I mean, that's what she does. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with being a Republican. There's nothing wrong with being, a conservative Republican. Well, there is if you're discriminating against people. But there's nothing wrong with that. But when people that select her are appointed by Republicans, not because they're experts in higher education, but because they give money, the whole thing starts to smell. It didn't have to smell at all. All they had to do was just bring three people on campus. That's it. But I think they so much wanted Heather Wilson for some reason that they took the process away from where we could have had input.
Right, and I'm so glad you brought that up because I was debating right now whether I should bring that up. You know, Paul Foster is actually part of the Board of Regents.
Right.
And that, for me, when I found that out, that just raises big flags. She gets money from Hunt. What's the first name? I'll remember the last names. So from Hunt and
Woody
also
Hunt.
Woody Hunt for her campaigning when she was a New Mexico senator.
And Woody Hunt gave to her, our current mayor gave to her,
yes.
And Foster gave to her.
Yes.
And that goes back as far as 2005, that they've been contributing to her campaign. You know, every time she runs for Congress or running for something, they contribute. That's really problematic.
Yes.
When I've been giving, like do you say, oh, this is I've never met her, I don't know her, there's no conflict of interest. Well, there's got to be some kind of conflict of interest if you've been giving money to her and you want her to get elected, and then you invite her. Wasn't she invited to apply for the position?
I don't know, but if she was invited,
that we can ask. Mm-hmm. Was she invited to apply for the position? Did she apply for it on her own because she heard about it? I don't think she had time to hear about it. She's the Secretary of the Air Force.
Right.
So someone told her, or encouraged her to apply. There is nothing wrong with encouraging anybody to apply.
No, no, absolutely not.
In fact, in every search, I have been contacted when other universities have searches, and they say, "Ben, there's a job here and there. That job is perfect for you. You should apply." I never did because I didn't want to leave El Paso. I'm fine here. I'm fine. But encouraging other people to apply for a position is like part of a job search. Now, it doesn't seem a natural fit to ask you to apply. But if Woody Hunt or Mr. Foster or the current mayor asked you to apply and then said she was the best candidate, then we have a problem.
Yes.
And it's reasonable to say there's a problem here. I'm not just, you know, I am, you know, I really wished that they'd hired someone that we didn't know their politics. And there would be no reason to know their politics because they weren't in politics. Mm-hmm. They were in education. Why are we hiring someone who is in politics and spent most of her career in politics to be a university president? Why aren't we picking someone who's been in education for the last 25 years?
Not even that, but just somebody who's terrible in politics.
Well, no, but we get partisan. And that's fine. I know, and I, you know, that, you know, I'm a Democrat, so, you know, yeah, and that's fine. But I'm not opposed to hiring a Republican per se. Again, I said I don't know Diana's politics, but if I found out that she wasn't a Democrat, I could have cared less. It's not my business to know. Again,
Kirkley.
they've made that kind of like the issue. When we do that, of course, we can step back and say there's a real problem with the way that we do business in Texas with the Board of Regents. We should pick people in that field and pick them because they are experts. But that's not what we do at all. And I remember a long time ago, I have this anecdote. The first Texas Book Festival, my ex-wife and I sat with the Bushes. I knew Laura through Adair Margo and for the arts, and I'd met her when she'd come to town and all of that. So I got a phone call from Laura, and she said, will you and Patricia be our guests at the Texas Book Festival? I said, well, sure. That was kind of gracious, I thought. So I'm sitting next to Governor Bush, and then we're talking. He knows I'm a professor. And he says, you know, Ben, I want to be the education governor. And I said, well, governor? He said, no, call me George. George, why is it that every time we are trying to revamp education and looking at what's wrong with it and what we should do, we never have on-the-ground teachers on those investigation panels and see what we can do? And he says, well, why, Ben? We don't want the fox guarding the hen house. And I didn't skip a beat. And I said, well, funny how that doesn't apply to oil and gas.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said, well, in oil and gas, we need experts. There, which is like, this is a weird conversation, but I'll tell you, I've always remembered it, because they don't feel that education is important enough to put experts on those committees and on those boards that affect education, because it's not important enough. Oil and gas, we need experts. Well, there's something wrong here. I mean, that's an attitude. That doesn't have anything to do with Ms. Wilson, except for it has everything to do with it, because we have a process that doesn't skew towards professionalism. And that's a problem. I think Ms. Wilson is happily taking advantage of that process. I don't understand. And then that's the other thing. Okay, El Paso is a heavily Democratic town. You might respect that, you might not respect that. It doesn't matter. That's who we are. You know, our current president got 26% of the vote. That's really like that bad. He got 26% of the vote. They know that. They know that. They are very staunch members of the Republican Party. So why is it appropriate? We get partisan because it is partisan. Why is it appropriate for Republicans to nominate a Republican to be the president of a highly Democratic town? What kind, is that respect? I think that's shoving something down someone's throat.
No, yeah.
Yes. You know, frankly. And why is it not reasonable for me to say that? Am I being crazy? Isn't there a logic to the way that I'm feeling right now? I might be overreacting a little bit, but nevertheless, it does kind of logical. Well, no, wait a minute. Let me see. But again, the process has been politicized by their choice. None of this would have happened if they had selected anybody else. We wouldn't even be talking about partisan politics. And so they've put partisan politics into the process of selecting a university president. And they did that. I didn't. I'm just responding to it or calling them on it. And I'm sure they would like, you know, they wouldn't like to hear something like, well, this is like, they would like to hear my reduction of like, this is Republicans nominating a Republican in a Democratic town. They wouldn't like that. But in fact, that's true. Did they intend to do that? Maybe not. But that I perceive that is not unreasonable. And that I react against it is not unreasonable, especially in these times where I happen to think that, you know, President Trump is not just any Republican. He is President Trump. Yeah. And and in my opinion, and in many people's opinion, he has the most corrupt administration we have ever seen in modern history. That a reasonable person can say that and can prove that. She comes from that administration. She didn't have any qualms about joining that administration. You know, I wouldn't have joined that administration even if I was a Republican. No, I don't want to work for you. And there's also a rumor, and that's, I've read it many times in the newspaper, that she was about to be let go because there was differences of opinion, or he wanted somebody else. Well, who knows? You know, Mr. Trump is not, it's not easy to read. So she was looking to jump ship anyway. And all of this sounds really convenient. Now, but to go back, what if we were to say about a hiring process, what questions were asked? I think we can ask for that. We're not asking for who applied. What questions were asked? And are those questions appropriate to the hiring of a university president at UTEP and on the border? Were those appropriate questions? Were we actually looking for a candidate that was a good fit? And we can tell that by the questions. Is that, were we doing an honest evaluation of a president that would be good for us and could lead us into the next century? Or are there other agendas involved? I hate to ask all these questions. I really do. But I am asking them. And I think that they are reasonable. And you think, I have better things to do than to be monitoring the situation, believe me.
No, I mean, we all have better things to do. You know, the students especially, the students that were gathering this week, they had midterms. We had a lot of things that we needed to do, but we were focusing on this issue that doesn't need to be focused on, really, if it had been done the right way.
How do you think the general population of the students feel?
Well, a lot of the students aren't really educated in the sense, like, they have no idea. I have, like, my husband goes to UTEP as well as my cousin and a few other people that I know. Like, they had no idea what was going on. They were misinformed. They didn't know. So I had to go down the line and give them these resources that Mike has over here, you know, that says exactly what her background is, exactly where she comes from. And my cousin ended up signing the petition after reading it, and mm-hmm. so did my husband. And my husband's a Republican, you know? And the first thing he said was, you know, no, this is crony capitalism. There is no way I want this over at my, you know, at this university that I'm attending. And he's not even from El Paso. So for me, if he's already saying no, it for me, I realize that, you know what, there's more to this than what it seems. There's like all the questions you were asking. Like, those are all the questions that went, I bet, through a lot of people's minds. It's just, as a student, a lot of the times all you're thinking about is, how am I going to finish my homework? How am I going to do this paper?
Yeah, pass this class. Yes. Yeah.
And will this ever, ever end?
Yes. Yes. You know, so for us to have to, you know, pretty much not even put it in the back burner, but have to multitask and do all those things together, it becomes difficult, you know? And then, like, granted, I'm only taking two classes, but I'm getting swamped, you know, being a part of this. You know, but I also feel that this is going to affect my education, you know, like what's going to happen if she ends up getting appointed and then the program that I'm in ends up getting funding cut because it's going somewhere else, you know, then I'm going to have to be forced to move to a different university when I want to be here in El Paso because I love El Paso. It's where I was born. It's where I was raised.
I don't know if I'm a pessimist or an optimist. By disposition, I'm an optimist. But in terms of politics, I'm pretty pessimistic. I'm not raising my voice because I think that anything's going to change. I believe that Heather Wilson's going to come here. I believe it's a done deal. But I also believe that I have to say, like, you know what? Thanks for the gift, but no, thank you. And I feel strongly that way. And I don't have to agree. I know that I've heard several adults say, why are they? They're just whining about this. They're just like being anti-establishment and just a bunch of whiners. And then I said to this guy, I'm proud of them. They're getting involved. They're raising their voices. They feel they should be a part of a democratic process. They want to have their say. They want to organize themselves, which they're free to do so. And that's a lot of work. So they're involving themselves in a responsible democratic process, and I'm proud of them. And I don't care what they're saying. On that point, everyone should be proud of you. But they're not. And I remember very clearly on Twitter, there was this man who'd been in the military a long time, and he'd fought in, I don't know, Afghanistan, I don't know where. And he says, I did not fight for this country in order for those brats to be misbehaving like that. And I responded to him. I said, sir, that is precisely why you fought.
Correctly.
It's called democracy.
Yes.
You fought to keep this country free. You cannot toss the words freedom around. If you believe that you fought for this country because you believe in the democratic principles and people's right to speak, then you did fight for them Correctly. To have their voice. Or if you didn't, then, you know, I'd like to know, you know, why you were fighting, because that's exactly the point. And I think that that's one of the things that that encourages me is that people said that UTEP doesn't have a history of students being politically involved. Oh. That happens not to be true, by the way. It happens absolutely. In the 60s, they took over the president's office.
Yes. Yes.
You know, they did. And there have been many times when the students have wanted their voices heard. There was an issue of free speech on campus. And so we had to have rules like where can you do your political thing? Everywhere on campus or where? Are there designated areas? We had to make it clear because some student had been called into the carpet for, I don't remember what the issues were, for, you know, what I thought were issues of free speech. But I think it was inappropriate for some reason. And so we had to clarify that. Because a campus has to be pro, you know, the freedom of speech is very important to me. And why not actually be supportive of a freedom of expression on a university campus? So that's interesting. But I do think that I really feel bad about this whole thing. And I'm disappointed. And I also, you know, like, I don't always believe everything I think. You know, I get all riled up and I get all excited and there I go, you know. And so, you know, I know that and I want to check myself. But I'm just really disappointed because from my perspective, I want to see progress. I mean, I've retired from UTEP. I taught for there for 23 years. I'm not affected by it. And yet I am because that university is going to create our future leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And someone my age wants to just pass the torch. Take it away, boys, girls. Come on, go. Go, girl. You know, take it away. It's your turn. It's your turn to try and mold a world that's a better place. I'm very disappointed in my generation. We started off good, but I think that sometimes that a lot of that talk in my generation was just around doing what the hell we wanted to do. You know, don't trust anybody over 30. Well. No, that's true. Don't trust anyone over 30. We say, and we certainly liked the free love and all of that business. We were all about that, you know. But were we really about creating a society that was equitable? And I thought that, and I think some people were, but they've always been the minority. How many people were involved, percentage of the population were involved in the women's movement? A small part. How many people were involved in the Chicano rights movement? A very small part. How many people were involved in the civil rights movement for African American? They had a better percentage. They had, you know, like, so, but still, it wasn't the majority of black people fighting. You know, many of them, a huge percentage, but not the majority. The majority of people are not activists, even though our generation is characterized by activism. You know, it's just that those that were organizing, it was new. The whole thing of, it was really cool to have on the issue of the cover of Life magazine, women's libbers, having their bra, burning the bra, you know, which is, it was great theater. But, you know, the kind of society that we have to ask ourselves, what kind of society do we want to live in? The choices we make today are going to create tomorrow's future. I don't think that Heather Wilson is about the future. I think she's about the past. People note that she has a good relationship with the military, and that's extracurricular to what happens at a university. I've said this before, that I am terribly old-fashioned. I want a university president to be an intellectual. Heather Wilson is not an intellectual. She's not, and she wouldn't call herself one either. She would think, I think she'd be baffled by the question if you asked her that. But we should claim that, because if we ought to start confronting our culture that it is incredibly and dangerously anti-intellectual. When you create an anti-intellectual society, then you can dismiss science, and thereby dismiss climate change. It allows you to do that. When you have an anti-intellectual climate in a society, it allows you to create discourses that dismisses experts. So it becomes the university philosophy professor who makes under $100,000 a year, who is the elitist. In fact, who are the elitists? The oligarchy. They are the definition of elitist. And yet we're accusing the university professor of being an elitist. And why do we do that? Because it's a convenient way that very conservative people can create a climate and a reason not to listen to anything they have to say, despite the fact that they have spent their entire lives using their minds to think about everything that they do. You know, we're creating a climate where words don't mean what they used to mean. And it's like we question the meaning of words, and we're untethering ourselves from truth. And I don't like that. I don't like that you can have a politics that says this on the one hand, and then say, you know, I respect everybody. You know, and I'm going like, well, how does any of this make sense? I know that consistency has never been a human trait. I understand that. I just have to look at myself for that example. I understand that we're not consistent. But sometimes there are inconsistencies that there's such a thing as an inconsistency, and there's such a thing as hypocrisy and duplicity. Which is it? We shouldn't throw those words around either. But it's true, we live in a climate where we do have a president that can say anything he wants. He doesn't remember saying the things he did. I didn't say that, and then you show him the tape. You did say that. And sometimes he responds, and sometimes he doesn't respond. But you can't just make things up. You know, And to the point of what is the border? Mr. Trump has decided this is what the border is. And he even though they tell him that it's not true and all the experts tell him it's not true, they're telling him that we don't need a wall. The experts are telling him, actually. He's not going to listen to that. So he comes to El Paso and makes a speech and says, when they built that wall, that's when crime went down. That's a lie. That's just a lie.
No, yeah.
So he lies about us, right? He lies about who we are because he wants to build a wall. We have been a safe city long before any of those things were there. And it's not, and people tell him, the experts say, no, that's not true. And it doesn't matter. And it doesn't matter because,
of course, because it doesn't go along with his narrative.
And he's militarizing the border. Why is he militarizing the border? Because when you put all of those kinds of fences up with the barbed wire like this, it looks like a war zone. And physically, he made it look like a war zone. It becomes a war zone. All of that has to do with truth and what is happening. When we have an anti-intellectual climate, then we also untether ourselves from history and the road we have gotten to where we are today. When we dismiss history, when we dismiss science, because we're such an anti-intellectual society, then we don't have to teach it, we don't have to know it, we can deny it, and then we can, for instance, they are today, there are some factions of people in the South, they want to have classes in that we can be biblically literate. And I say, I think we should be biblically literate too. We can begin with you people. Because, well, I'm an ex-priest. I know the Bible. I studied it for 8 years. The Christ that they present to people has absolutely nothing to do with the Jesus that is presented to us in the New Testament. People, if you are a racist, you are disqualified from being a Christian. Being a Christian you're not a Christian because you say you're a Christian. You know, you say you're a Christian because that you follow the tenets of Christianity. You cannot hate in the name of love. You can't do that. That's not Christian. And you know, there are Christian virtues, and one of them is forgiveness. One of them is, read the Beatitudes, blessed are the poor. Blessed are the meek of heart, the humble. All of these beautiful things, all of which are not present in our public discourse, but we should at least try to be forgiving. We should at least try, and, if Jesus wasn't an American. He wasn't a Russian either, you know. No, he wasn't, and he wasn't. No. It's like God is not on our side. You know, what is the whole idea of God? Is the idea, even if you're an atheist, you say, "Well, we created the idea of God." But even if we did, it's supposed to be a lovely idea. It's supposed to be an idea of like how we belong to each other, how we follow certain guidelines that make us virtuous people. And so in the end, do I believe, to segue back into what we're talking about, do I believe that Heather Wilson is a virtuous person? No. I do know that she has made herself a very wealthy woman by what she's done. She became a lobbyist almost as soon as she left Congress. And I thought it was supposed to be a law that you can't do that. But she did it, and somehow, and they investigated her, mm-hmm. and she was cleared of breaking any law. But that doesn't mean what she did was ethical.
Exactly.
You want to read me all your research?
Oh yes.
Thank you.
So, we're calling ourselves a student coalition. As a student coalition, we've all gathered resources with each other. We've all researched everything together. There's a website actually up. It's called blockheatherwilson.com. It lists every single thing she's done publicly when she was in Congress, after Congress, leading up to even now.
You want to just read that out for us?
Yes. So there's different points in this research that we've made. First part is her educational background. Second is her career background. Third is it appears why she was fired by Trump. We've done that research on that. The fourth thing we've done in the research is the Foster and Hunt
connection.
Mm-hmm. Donors.
It's like the Rainbow Connection.
Right? Yes. And she was actually president of the University of South Dakota.
Right.
Before she was...
There was a controversy there too.
Yes, there was.
What would we do without laptops?
I know, right? I had a paper with all my pointers. Are you connected to the
internet? Not really.
We can't connect here, can we?
I don't think we can.
No.
And then the sixth point that we found is, while she was in office, her votes on the education, her votes on education. Seventh is her votes on immigration. Eighth is her votes on civil rights. The ninth point of topic that we have is, while in office, her votes for the LGBT rights. Point number 10 is her work as a shadow lobbyist. And 11 is the citizens and ethicals and responsibility, giving her the most corrupt.
The most corrupt.
Politician in 2007. So
it's kind of like the Ped Fogg man.
Yes. So I don't know if you want to go ahead and get in on this.
Sure. On which part do you want me to? Let's see.
Just go through it.
Oh, it's not one of those. There we go. So one of the reasons why. Hold on. There we go. There we go. Okay.
So.
So it seems that it appears that she might have been fired by the Trump administration because of their disagreement over the Space Force, that she was against it and he was for it. So she,
the Space Force,
you know, like the space, like kind
Space of like, Force was an idea of Trump's to militarize outer space.
Yes.
Oh. Yeah.
Almost like Star Wars.
Star Wars, baby.
Yeah, basically, that's the first thing, yes. I thought too. So because of that, there was a report that said that Shanahan was particularly angered by Wilson Space Force position in the Air Force Times, that she was against it. So I just, like you said, it's kind of convenient that, you know, she's leaving the administration and then somehow, you know, planted here at UTEP. Also, Hunt and Foster have been campaign donors to her for years.
2005.
So 2005. So he's donated about, so he donated in 2005, $1,000. And then again in 2006, another $1,000. And then, well, no, 2006, he did it twice. And then, oh no, I lied. Look at that. It's like about $5,000 in 2006. And there's
she,
also.
And she is in New Mexico, not here.
Yes, New Mexico.
Right. Exactly. And, you know, well, I guess before I continue, I want to give out Cassidy a shout out for doing the website, because this person put together everything that we were already posting, mm-hmm. and just made it into a website for everybody to be able to go there and yes. see everything.
She made it accessible for the public to come and see what yes. her record is.
There's also a section right in the beginning where you can contact the Texas Board of Regents to let them know that you're dissatisfied with this. It has Paul Foster, Ernest Aliceda, David Beck, Kevin, how do you pronounce that? Altife? Jeffrey Hildebrand, Sarah Martinez Tucker, James Weaver, and Brittany Jewell, which is the student regent. So there's just so, oh, and also has a petition that we
yes.
that we put up on change.org, where you can go there and sign the petition if you haven't.
Say?
Let's see. It's pretty much all the information. Oh wait.
Yeah.
There's no internet. It's pretty much all the information. Yeah, my phone.
Yeah, you can put your hotspot. See?
Technology.
Technology.
There's a will, there's a
way. Yeah, there's the petition is, let me see.
The string away from the petition really quickly. All those names and numbers that are on there, I urge everybody to blow up their phones if you disagree with the matter. If you do not want Heather Wilson, blow up their phones. That is the best thing that you can do, in my opinion. Is let them know your opinion.
Right. I think that, you know, as I said, I do believe it's a done deal, but we don't have to go along quietly.
Yes.
Right, exactly. So I was able to pull up the petition, and it says pretty much what it says here on this website, but it gives you, yes, absolutely. Here you go. It shows the voting record. It shows everything. Just scroll it up.
It went away.
Oh, no, what happened?
It went away. It's always my niece. When I took her to Star Wars with the Ewoks.
Yeah.
And she was 5 or 6.
Here
and
you
then
go.
They have the Ewoks. And then the Ewoks would be on. And then the Ewoks would go away because there was a different scene. And she would kind of yell into the theater, "Uncle Ben, where did the Ewoks go?" We call on the Texas Board of Regents, the governing body for the University of Texas system, to with. Oh, your mic.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah. Can I talk loud enough? I don't, really. No, I did it again.
Sorry, my phone turns off after a few seconds. Here we go.
Okay, this is what the petition says. We call on the Texas Board of Regents, the governing body for the University of Texas system, to withdraw Heather Wilson as the finalist for president of the University of Texas at El Paso. Wilson has a clear history of being anti-LGBTQ, as reflected in her voting record as a former U.S. Congresswoman from New Mexico, and more recently in her position as Air Force Secretary, where she reversed a rule to allow for anti-gay discrimination in 2013. For many students and staff, the university is a safe space to become and be freely who they are. Hiring someone that clearly does not reflect the ability to support that for LGBTQ students is harmful. Moving Heather Wilson as a sole finalist and potential next president of UTEP endangers the university's ability to earnestly act and serve in the best interests of all its students. Other major concerns include Wilson's record of voting against the interests of students who depend on financial aid or loans to pay for their education. Records show that she voted against lowering student loan rates and against providing year-round Pell Grants, which is money the government provides to support students with financial need, and voted against millions of dollars that would have supported a new graduate Hispanic serving institution program. Wilson attacked an anti-LGBT bullying bill. She voted in favor of a federal amendment to the U.S. Constitution that would ban marriage equality and voted against the protections of the LGBTQ community. She also voted against a bill that would protect people in the workplace from being discriminated against based on their sexual orientation. UTEP deserves better. UTEP and the El Paso community deserve a president that reflects the university's values and the ability to serve and represent the best interests of all students. We call on the Texas Board of Regents to take action before the state required 21-day waiting period and withdraw Heather Wilson as the sole finalist. And that's all it said. That's it. We've come to the end of it. Nicely done. Yes. Nicely done.
That was Christina Calvillo Rivera.
And how many people have signed on?
Actually, it says here 8,800, and we're trying to get to 10,000. And this was in a matter of it's already been 5 days.
Where do all these people come from that are signing this petition?
From my understanding of it, the analytics are showing that it's coming from the El Paso Juarez area.
Oh, nice. That's great. So it's not—they're not outsiders.
No, not outsiders. It's the Paso Juarez area, and I believe also Las Cruces. I'm not mistaken.
All of which have vested stake in it because New Mexico, Las Cruces, Doniana County, young people can get in-state tuition here at UTEP, and then people from El Paso County can get in-state tuition at New Mexico State because they have that interchange, and the students from Chihuahua, state of Chihuahua, can also have in-state tuition.
Yes.
So there are
they are our not clients. They are our audience. And go on.
No, I was saying yes, absolutely. I was agreeing with you.
But what else do you have?
We have that her votes on education that we've already discussed, saying that she voted yes on an additional, what was it, 10.2, am I reading this right? Yeah, voted yes to an additional $10.2 billion for federal education and HHS projects. She voted no on allowing courts to decide on God in Pledge of Allegiance. She voted no on $84 million in grants for Black and Hispanic colleges. Voted yes on allowing school prayer during the War on Terror. Voted yes on requiring states to test students. Voted yes on allowing vouchers in D.C. schools. Let schools display the words, God Bless America. Rated 33%, like Mike has already said, 33% by the NEA in indicating anti-public education votes and supported funding for teacher training and other initiatives. So granted, there are some stuff that was okay, but the ones that are the big ones that are just no, like absolutely no, are the ones that are going to be affecting our community the most, which is the, where is it? Hispanic colleges that saying no for $84 million in grants for Black and Hispanic colleges. That's, I mean, the majority of the population here is right. Hispanic. It's just, yeah. Do you want to read the immigration one?
Yes. Okay. Thank you. While she was in office, her immigration, she voted yes on building a fence along the Mexican border. We don't, as we discussed before, the fence isn't needed, in my opinion.
In many experts' opinions.
Yes. Voted yes on preventing tipping of undocumented immigrants about the Minuteman Project. She voted no on reporting illegal aliens who receive hospital treatment. She voted yes on extending immigrant residency rules. She voted yes on immigrant visas for skilled workers. She rated zero by FAIR, indicating a voting record, loosening immigration. She's rated 33% by USBC, indicating a mixed record on open borders. So she is very divided within immigration.
When people say open borders, what do you think they mean by that?
In my opinion, I believe it's not.
It doesn't mean no borders.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean people, a lot of people interpret open borders as no borders.
No, that I don't believe it's that. I believe it's the accessibility of going between borders.
Right.
And also trading.
Yes, like, and trade.
Right. Like yeah. also trading and being able to come and go and being able to work. Like there's a lot of people from Juarez who come here that come here to work. And there's even people here in El Paso that go to Mexico to work. So it's not technically an open border of, you know, just it's a free for all. Everybody come over here. No, we have to work together. We, you know, like I said, we're a binational community. And that's how it's always worked here in El Paso.
Does the mayor's office have statistics on the contributions of Mexicans to our economy? I ask that because, you know, if you go to South El Paso, a lot of those people are shopping here and they're from Mexico. They come over to shop, which means that they don't come over to take. They come over to contribute to our economy. But there are numbers to that. And I wonder if the mayor's office has that.
That's a good question. That's something perhaps we have to look into. Maybe go either down there or go through the website. Something to see if it's there. Because they do, especially during Christmas time. You know, at Christmas time, it gets flooded here with so many people. You know why? Because there's a lot of people from Mexico coming over to put into our economy. And then they go back, you know?
Right.
But that's great.
I think that's great. One of the sad things for Juarez during when the violence began is that the people from El Paso no longer went over there and contributed money to their
economy
because we stopped going. And it became more that people from Juarez would come over here and do the young people at that time. I think that stopped. But at one point, the young people of Juarez would all come over here to drink, to dance, to, you know, have a good time because they didn't want to be out on streets that were dangerous. And that really hurt their economy, but helped ours.
And when 60,000 people moved here during the height of the violence, that helped our economy and really crushed theirs. Because the people that moved here were basically, you know, well-to-do. Or at least, you know, upper middle class, because they could afford to live here. You can't just come here and not have money. When you move somewhere, you have to have resources in order for those things to happen. I don't know exactly what the rules are, but I know that, you know, by the way, you do know that in immigration, you can buy your way in. If you invest $200,000 in a business for 5 years, you can get an automatic visa to come to the United States. So that's the law. You can look it up. That's really interesting. You can buy your way in.
That's interesting.
That part I did know, and that's so, I mean, I understand, so that better helps our economy. However, what about everyone else who's still in line? You know, it's, I don't know. It's like a good thing, but then it's a bad thing. It just depends on how you view it.
Well, let's not kid ourselves. Borders are made to keep out the poor. Yeah. The rich can go anywhere they want, anytime they want, from any country they want. And that's the truth. We don't want poor people in this country. I know, I get that. Who wants more poor people in their country? But really, that's what we're doing. And unfortunately, the people who are today coming to the United States seeking political asylum are poor. You know, mobility, you know, power can be defined as the ability to act. Poor people are not mobile in the same way that rich people are. Some people, if you're really poor, you never leave your neighborhood. You can't. You just kind of stay there. You're not that mobile. Wealthy people can act because they're very mobile. I count myself among them. I'm not like a wealthy man. I can go anywhere I want. I can. If I wanted to be a citizen of France, I'm sure I could become one. I don't want to. But I can go anywhere because I have a passport. I have means. I can actually afford to go there. I'm not oppressed. I'm not seeking political asylum. You know, sometimes I want to. Sometimes I say, like, oh, I'm so tired of the way that men behave. We're such I don't know, idiots. And I said, well, I wonder if there's such a thing as getting a passport and live in the country of woman instead of the country of man. You know, political asylum, you know. But I just really feel that we should be honest about this and examine that. I'm not saying not to have borders. You know, that's what nationalisms are all about. Every country has its border and they have a right to... you know, let anybody in for any reason they want. But we should not pretend that those reasons are necessarily moral, fair, and compassionate. You know, we can do anything we want and we let anybody in we want, but let's not pretend that we're good. And that's my problem with it all. Don't take the moral high ground. We can say we can do it because we can do anything we want as a nation. And it, do it. But don't say that you're good. It's like really what I resent about Christians who aren't Christians. You know, if you want to hate, but don't do it in the name of God. Don't throw them under the bus. It's not God's fault. That's a decision you made. Mm-hmm. And I resent that because I do believe that spirituality is important. And frankly, as a Catholic, you know, I have my problems with the Catholic Church, but, you know, I'm still a Catholic. Why am I still a Catholic? Because I find something in that faith that feeds my spirituality. And we have spiritual traditions in Catholicism that are thousands of years old, and some of those traditions work for me. That's the tradition. So I find something beautiful in Catholicism, but there's a lot of things I don't like about Catholicism, but they're not innate to the church. You know, to hide, to protect priests who abuse children, that's terrible. That's a crime. That's a sin. That is horrible. And that's what the Catholic Church did. But that's not part of what they're supposed to stand for. It's against what they're supposed to stand for. Now, me being gay and, you know, their love for me, which is non-existent, is a problem. But I make a decision that says, just because the church doesn't love me doesn't mean that I don't love the church. doesn't have to mean that. And that's a decision I make. But I like to make my decisions more thoughtfully and not just react to them. We have so much reaction instead of like, and being thoughtful is not important anymore in our discourse. We can just pop off. I don't like that. I don't think that. And that we go back to the whole idea of being an intellectual. Part of the beauty of being an intellectual that it demands of you to look at all the look at all of the evidence, not just the evidence that you like, all of it. You can't write a dissertation, by the way, at any university and not include all of the research that is, in fact, is the opposite of what you're arguing. You include it, and then you make your argument. But you can't just leave it out, because you're not going to get a degree. You can't just leave out the information. You can't just include the information that agrees with you. And that is like an actual academic, honest endeavor. And I would like a president that represents that. And I don't think she does. Just because, you know, she's just not. I mean, when you hire someone that's from that is a public figure in a political party, Democrat or Republican, I think you should be disqualified. You know, you should be. You're a partisan. You can be front partisan. I don't want to take away her freedom of speech. Someone said that. Well, she can think whatever she likes. Oh, yeah, well, she can. But that doesn't mean that may disqualify her of being a public figure and a university president. She's a state employee. She's a public servant. She's a public servant for us all. And I really believe in public service. When I was a university professor at UTEP for 23 years, you know, I didn't call myself a professor. You know, I didn't get my doctorate. And some people call me Professor Science. But my students would say, oh, Dr. Science, I said, well, I didn't finish my PhD. I don't want to misrepresent myself. Why don't you just call me Mr. Science? I'm a teacher. I don't think it's like important to me to call myself a professor. I was a teacher. I was a public servant. I was paid for the state to do a job. They weren't there. The university did not exist just to buy time for me so I could have money to write books. No. They were there for me to do a job. And I believe in doing that job and having some integrity about it. And I will also believe that one of the things that integrity has to do with money. Well, I may be many things, but every dime I've ever made, I came by honestly. And I don't think that Miss Wilson can say that. And I think that we should be examples to young people. And I think the whole moneyed interest, she comes here tainted. Do you gonna tell me that you know, she is not gonna be friends of the people that had her appointed? That's gonna skew her point of view. You know, I don't have anything totally negative to say about capitalism. I think it should be tamed. I think it should be fair, but capitalism is such. We're not going to do away with it. We should deal with it. But it doesn't mean you have to be mean. It doesn't mean you don't have to pay your workers. And it's really interesting because all of the community members that we had on this committee were business people. Yes. They have interests. Why don't you pick a community member? Why don't you pick someone that's involved in the community outside of their job? No one there was doing that. In other words, no one there was altruistic. They all had interests. And I don't like that because I don't want money to be involved in the picking of university presidents. And Texas particularly is not much of a watchdog for those kinds of issues. And that's problematic. Again, we come to what kind of world do you want it to be? What kind of world are you trying to create?
For me, it's a world of transparency and fairness. I believe we're owed that, at least. Or not owed it, but it should just automatically be given. I don't know how to say it. Yes. Because I believe that to not inform the community, not inform the student body, not inform anybody about what the decision was or what was going on or who were the finalists, really like took that away from the community's voice. It was just like, here she is, whether you like her or not, there you go.
We know better.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. For me, it's, I have three kids. Uh-huh. One of them is going to be graduating in 2020. So he's going to be going to college. Do I want him to go to college at a university that, you know, that whose president is, for lack of a better word, than the way you said it, tainted? It's, I don't want him there. You know, I would not want him to go to a university like that. You know, my other two kids, they still have a long ways. Like one of them's 13 years, the other one is 8 years away. You know, but my child that's going to be, you know, he's going to be a senior next year. You know, I want him to be able to go to university and not feel that whatever he believes in or whatever he wants to do, it's going to be looked upon, you know, as this, I don't want to say a bad thing, but like, you know, he's Mexican, you know, he doesn't look Mexican, which I think that's part of his privilege, you know, but I don't want him to go to a school where that's going to affect him if they see his last name. And that's pretty much for me, it's, I want to be on the right side of history. I want to fight to make sure that the future is good for my children. You know, I mean, that's pretty much it. And that, because, you know, of everything that I feel with everything that I've learned, but the big one is it's my kids.
That's very compelling.
For me, it's my niece also. She's 1.5, so she still has like a while to get there, but I want her to go somewhere where whatever she decides to be in life, whoever she decides to be in life, whatever she was born to be in life, that she'll be accepted somewhere where there's no bias of, this is who you are, we don't want to accept you. I want her to go somewhere where it's like, it's open, and if it's open, it's affordable, it's for anybody and all. Because that's what I feel education is. I feel education is, should be an outlet for everybody, not just the privileged few.
When I came to UTEP in 1992, I knew that there are many people in the English department that did not want me as a faculty member, but they didn't have much of a choice but to hire me because I was the most qualified candidate. And they were starting a bilingual MFA program, and I was the only bilingual candidate. They would have been hard put to not hire me. I think one of the attitudes were many. And at the time, certainly not today, but at the time, there was a lot of, you know, stealth racists. I was never supported. I was, my second year here exposed the racism in the English department, and perhaps that was present on campus at the time. I won a very important award called the Lannan Foundation Poetry Fellowship for $50,000. They did an article on the newspaper. I never really said anything to my colleagues. Oh, look, I want this big award. But they published it, and they published the winners every year, and then a whole page in the New York Times. And most of my colleagues at UTEP read the New York Times, and there is my name. So people would ask me. I didn't even tell them. Oh, so was that an award for minorities? And I wanted to say, did you read the list? No. But that was like by way of congratulations. Was that for minorities? Because obviously they would only give me an award if it was like for minorities. And another colleague said to me, oh, that must be a misprint in the Times. It must have been $5,000, not $50,000. This by way of congratulations. They're not saying congratulations. And then another one told me, this is a killer. Back before the PC police were out, we would have called you nigger rich. This is a full professor. I am an untenured faculty. I didn't even know what to say. I really didn't. I was hired, there was two professors hired that year, me and a man named Scott Michelson, who was my colleague. As a welcome to him, he was invited to almost every professor's house for dinner to welcome to the department. I was invited to nobody's house. Another professor told me, by way of congratulations on this award, we were going to meet with the whole department, and she says to me, "Well, what are you going to do about your career? when the border isn't in vogue anymore? Because isn't that why you want it? And I had it. And I said it really loud, because we're all waiting for the meeting to begin. I called her by her name and I said, you know, in my culture, when something nice happens to somebody, we say congratulations. We don't say it in English, but we say it. Obviously, in your culture, you have a far different tradition. And I was so angry, and I was really hurt, because no one in my department celebrated an award which most writers in this country would die for. And I didn't even mention it to him. And I thought, really? They don't like me and they don't want me. Why? Because I'm a Mexican and apparently a very successful one. And I had a really hard time I really did. They would, my rankings, you know, we have evaluations every year, and you can get from 5 to 1. I had really, I was in really, when I look back, incredible productivity. And they would give me a 2. And the dean would give me a 5, and he says, what are those people doing over there? You know, it was like, it was terrible, and I was treated terribly, and it was racism. It was. And it's almost as if, like, they really couldn't stand my success. I've been a very successful writer, but very lucky. And they couldn't stand it. And they treated me terribly. And the personnel, when I went up for tenure, there was no question that I should have been tenured at all, with my publications, my national awards, all the lectures I was asked to speak. And on the personnel committee, there were 7 people in the English department. And they voted against me 6-1. Why? Because what wasn't excellent? They wanted to, and I heard someone say once, well, can't get him on his teaching, his students love him. I heard them say that. Oh, okay. And I didn't get raises. I have a colleague who came later than me, and he's a good friend of mine. And he said, Ben, he was talking to the then chair, and because this new faculty member asked me my salary, and he said, that's really low for someone of your caliber, he said. He was a new faculty member. And he asked the chair about it. Oh, he said, we don't have to. He's telling this to an untenured, they're both white, an untenured faculty member, which is incredibly inappropriate. He says, we don't have to worry about giving Ben raises. He's not going anywhere. Against that background, you know, and I, you know, there was a time that I thought I wanted to leave. But, you know, I said to myself, no, this is where I want to live. This is my community. These are my people. They're not going to chase me away. They don't have to be nice to me. I'm tougher than that. They don't have to like me. And, you know, it's terrible to say, but sometimes you do have to say that success is the best revenge. You don't want revenge, but you think, Jesus Christ. And eventually, we did. I think things changed because we were hiring a faculty member. We were supposed to be hiring for a bilingual MFA, program. None of the applicants were bilingual, and we're supposed to be getting ready to start a bilingual MFA program. And the 2 applicants came, and I said, and then I picked out an applicant from the pool. His name is Daniel Chacon, who is the current chair of Creative Writing. And I said, why isn't he being interviewed? I wasn't on the committee, but I could go look at him. Why isn't he being interviewed? And the answer was, well, he can't go to MLA. MLA is it's our association of where we, every year people go interviewed. And he said, we can't go. Why can't he go to get interviewed then? Oh, because he's doing an exchange program with writers in Cuba. And I said, oh, we really don't want him, do we? They didn't want to find a way to interview him because they just dismiss him. You know what? If I hadn't gone through that pile, Daniel Chacon wouldn't be here, and he is an incredible faculty member. He and everybody respects and loves him, and they should. He would have been left out because they didn't want to hire a Latino, frankly. And he got hired. But he didn't get hired on as a regular faculty member. This is the thing, too. It became like an affirmative action kind of thing because they had monies at the time to hire, you know, you know, to up the ante. So, in a sense, you could say the most qualified candidate got a job through a special program that would hire people to up the ante because they don't hire people like him on a normal basis. There is institutional racism, and it has existed for UTEP and everywhere else. I'm not singling it out. But it is disappointing with that history. Because when I left UTEP, you know, everybody loved me, and everybody was, you know, they don't remember not supporting me. They don't remember, they didn't even want the bilingual program. We had to fight for a bilingual program that we wrote that would be bilingual. And when we got that program to start our MFA, we had two programs, one in the English department and one in Lang and Ling. And it wasn't bilingual. It was two separate programs. The Spanish speaker went over here. The English speakers, they didn't even know each other, the students. And that's how they implemented a bilingual program. And because they fought it. And that's the program we wrote. That's why it got accepted. Because it was different. And they didn't want to implement it. And we, kicking and screaming, we created one of the most interesting and important bilingual program in the country. What it was is that they just wanted to use us to get an MFA, and then the departments could go their merry way. And it makes me angry that I fought so many years to. Now I didn't do it alone, and I was just one of the voices to do something that really used our position strategically and culturally relevant to our students, and it's an intellectual program. And then to see this happen really disappoints me, because it seems like, you know, it just seems like, you know, have we made progress? And that is disappointing to me. And I'm glad I'm not on campus, because I would just be so furious. And I know I am, I'm not exactly a calm person. You know, I'm kind of high strung, you know, and I have a very unquiet mind. But, I suppose that what's my horse in this game? I'd like this university to be a great, great university because we are a great people. And we have been told for so many years, you're not good enough. I was told that as a faculty member. And maybe that made me a success because, you know what, I'm really stubborn. But we deserve excellence. We deserve to be a great university. And I know in my heart that Heather Wilson is not made of greatness. But I believe we are. And I believe we deserve it. And I'm going to leave it at that. Do you have anything on closing? Do you want to have anything to say?
No, I think I'm good. You pretty much put it right on.
Likewise, I think everything you've said is just completely spot on. Yes.
It's everything we wanted to say. It's like, wow, it's perfect.
Thank you for being on the show.
Thank you for having us.
And good luck. You know, good luck. Keep the faith.
Yes.
Thank you.
This is Benjamin Lilly the Science for Don't Be So Off the Wall. That's the name of my show. Don't Be So Off the Wall. Straighten up and fly right.
Straighten up and fly right. Cool down, Papa, don't you blow your top.